Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Greg Peterson, and I am one of the co-founders of the Robert Jackson Center here in Jamestown, New York. And we've just had a wonderful discussion here this morning regarding the Barnette decision, West Virginia versus Barnette of 1943. We have some of your friends and colleagues here who are listening in and will be joining as we proceed this your morning. We have Judith Gabaitis Close, who's here. We also have Louise Blanton, and we also have Marie Barnette Snodgrass. So we have, in the United States Supreme Court, we Gabaitis case, so we have the daughter of Lillian Gabaitis. Then for 3 years, they had Kingdom Hall, which Jehovah's Witnesses had to attend. We have Louise Blanton for that. And then we have Marie Barnette, whose family, and she was part of the case which ruled that it was unconstitutional to have the mandatory flag salute. And we're just thrilled you could join us. And I'm going to sort of just start the comments, because I know you have a story which our audience can't wait to hear about your life story, which is in the book Facing the Lion. As you had an experience we could only wonder about, but you actually lived it. So I just want to just start by, again, thanking you so much. But at the same time, for our audience, maybe you could put into perspective a little bit about your background and your religious background. I know your parents were originally Catholic, and if you could talk how you became a member of the Jehovah's Witness.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. We were strong Catholics, and we had a case in the Catholic Church about misbehavior with the priest with the boy. And my mother came to the conclusion that it was impossible that God would accept the prayers of that priest. So she decided to see if there is another way to get close to God. At that time we had two brothers who came from Switzerland. In those days, they were selling booklets. She bought 3 booklets, and that was sufficient for her. She started off preaching, hadn't seen any congregation, hadn't seen no one, but what she read, she knew. Otherwise, other people had to get it. So she started off preaching without any contact. And my father was opposed, but afterwards, she was reading the Bible to me, and one morning she was reading to me the Ten Commandments. She had promised her husband that she wouldn't teach me, so she never taught me. She just was reading, but she was reading with sense stress. She would come back on certain words of the reading. And when I learned that there was not to have any images, I went up and destroyed my images I had altered. And because of that, my father said, I have to get after that. I have to study to get her out of that religion because her daughter is being influenced. I was 7 years old when that happened. But due to the destruction of my altar, father realized that he had to do something. So he ordered a book, Creation, and in 3 days' time, he said to his wife, you found the truth. So my parents got baptized, that is my father, my mother first in 38, my father in 39, my mother's sister in 40, and me in 41. I was 11 years old. That was the time when the Germans came.
During that time period, can you explain a little bit about the school system that you were part of? Was there a public school system that you attended during your early years?
It was first public schools, but by the time the Germans came, I was switching over to a higher learning. It was a higher class. It was another school. But everywhere was the Heil Hitler. When the priest came in the room, when he went out, when we met him in the street, whenever, at least, I would say at least three or four times a day, we had to face it, Heil Hitler. And since it is a visual greeting, you could see if someone was greeting by lifting the arm. I always tried to turn myself so around that I was not in the light of the teacher's sight. And that went good for a whole year. In between, my father got arrested because he was known as a witness. And I continued in school. And then suddenly one day, I was outside the school, didn't see the teacher, didn't salute, and that was it. Then came the trials, very hard trials. First in the school, I had to go with a piece of paper from class to class in which it was said that the government cannot give any teaching to anyone who doesn't comply to the rules of the government. And this was a warning, and very little on the bottom, it was said this was to be presented in all classes as Simone Arnold. And that was a terrible test, because each class I was supposed to have. But you know, the Alsatians were not so Nazis, and no one ever reacted because I did not have it. But the city over the superintendent of the city came on Saturday. He made a terrible talk about the traitor and the most dirty speech, Nazi speech. Like Hitler would do the same type of words. And he said, the child who recognizes himself has to get up. So I stood up. He didn't give my name. So I had to go up in front of the class, 45 kids. And he had the papers there, and he said, if you don't greet, salute, you take the paper, you have to leave the school. And then he said the terrible thing, I give you 5 minutes to think it over. And it was true, 5 minutes. They were standing on the platform with the hand there and the watch. Those 5 minutes were absolutely awful. And I could not speak, I could not talk, I could not pray. I got stiff. I had only one thing in my mind. You want those papers and go out. You want those papers and go out. And then when the Heil Hitler came, I snapped the paper and I went out. And when I came outside, I had a wonderful feeling. I still feel it in my heart. That was a victory for me. And that was the end of the high schooling. I had to go to lower school. In the lower school, I got beaten. That was another kind of director. A mean creature, very nasty. And because of that, I had to go to the Gestapo. I had a one-hour examination by the Gestapo. They wanted to make a traitor out of me, that I would give names of all the witnesses. Well, it's true, I knew everything. I was in underground activity, so I knew all the brotherhoods. There were not many. German really handled the situation wonderfully. And after that, I had to appear in front of the judge, German judge, who decided that I was a very nice child, very polite, but corrupted by the teaching of my mother. And that's why I had to be taken away, get foster cared in another place. So I came in a re-educational home. And that home, there were only Germans. And those kids were all of households where the parents had serious problems with behavior, immoral, and so on. So in that place, we had absolute no right to talk to each other. Punishment for talking was terrible, absolutely terrible. It could go to a whole week, no evening meal. And we had hard work. It was non-stop. But it was quiet. There was never a high Hitler coming up because they said, you don't deserve the privilege of hailing Hitler because you are immoral, which was happy for me. It was a good thing. And my worst in the top place was to be a model in all work, in behavior. That was my goal. My mother had said, they have to know that Jehovah's Witnesses have a superior teaching, not a lower teaching as they want to make us believe. So my goal was to be very, very strict in everything. I never got punished in conscience in that place. The end of the war, or the end of the situation. In between, my mother was also arrested, so we were all three were arrested.
Simone, if I could, just to put into perspective, your mother and father were converted to Jehovah's Witness. They were baptized. What happened to your dad? Was he arrested?
Father got arrested at the factory. Unexpectedly, the Gestapo, the secret police, came to his working place. He was drawing a pattern for printing material. They asked him, are you Jehovah's Witnesses? He said, yes. He said, come along with us. So he had to take a bicycle and go home. The car was the police car behind, so everybody in the street could see that he was getting arrested. But that happened. I was in school and mother was out of the house, so we didn't know anything. At 2 o'clock in the afternoon, they came and had mother on a crossroad interrogation, starting up from 2 until 5 o'clock, constantly asking after watchtower meetings, other people and names. And I listened. I was in the next room. I listened to that. And that's where I got my teaching for myself. When it happened a year later, I knew what my mother had answered, so I could use the same thing. For instance, they would say, do you have the watchtower? She said, yes. So they jumped up and said, where did you get it from? Well, she said, you know, we got it from Switzerland as long as the border was open. No, we don't get it anymore because the border is closed. They couldn't do anything with that. And once they said, you have secret meetings, she said, what secret meetings? What do you mean? Anybody can follow me and come along and see where I go. There's nothing secret in my life. See, this way of answering very calmly, very politely, has given me a big lesson on how to handle the relationship. And there was one thing mother said, when you have to answer, talk right up to the face of your persecutors. See the face, look at them, don't look away, but above their head, see the angels. So you won't be influenced by the mean faces. And they will believe that you look at them. But you see behind the angels, and that's what I did all the time.
So your father is placed, arrested and placed in a concentration camp, and there he stayed really until 1945, is that correct? Did you have any contact with him at all? Did you were able to write letters or anything?
I had the right to write a letter per year for his anniversary. He had no right to write to me. He could write letters to his sister-in-law, the sister of my mother. She was a maid, and she could get through without too much difficulties. And she would get the letters every 3 months, 12 lines, that's all. And of course, nothing special. But mother was sending him. They could send food packages, and mother would make very thin copies of the Watchtower, very on secret paper, roll it together and put it between two cookies. And that's how father was kept informed of what happened. You know, brother Frodo died. Brother Noah came. He could get that. Mother wrote him a letter. In the letter she said that the brother is fought. And that means gone in German. The end of the sentence. And then she says, since that man is gone, we prefer the Knoch soup. There was a trade with the soup, which came from Knoch. And so she only wrote, we love the Knoch soup so much. And that's how my father got the connection that Rutherford had died and Knoch was taking over.
Simone, during that time period, you were with your mother until 1943, when you were then placed in a re-education house. What was happening at home with your mother? What happened to her after you left to go to the re-education location?
Well, there was a lady in the house. She went to the police and she said, I don't understand why the mother is still free. The father's gone, the girl is gone. What is she doing in freedom? So she got arrested and ran to camp.
So she went to, she was placed in a camp also?
Yes, but it was not a regular concentration camp. It was a camp the Nazi opened in Alsace to correct the Alsatian people, to get them on a straight way. But it was similar to concentration.
Your re-education test, did that test your faith? Were you confronted by the parents, the foster parents of the re-education location, to try to dissuade you from your beliefs as a Jehovah's Witness?
No. And I think it was due to my mother, because when I was arrested, my mother came along. She insisted. They were the foster ladies didn't want that, but my mother insisted. And then when we arrived, she was standing there, and the main persons of the place said, what is that lady? And they said, it's a child's mother. So she called her in and she said, I respect a mother who comes and brings herself the kid over here. And I believe that mother had a long interview with them, telling them exactly what happened, because I could feel a sort of a respect from the main leader and the second one, the teacher, which was a second-hand person, whatever, four of them. She was very much against the truth. And she was the one that once in a while would humiliate me and speak against Jehovah and so on. I just listened, didn't do anything.
In 1945, there's liberation of Europe, the war ends. June 6, 1945, and the concentration camp where your dad was located was liberated in May of 1945. Tell me about the reunion. At some point, your mother and you are connected with your dad. What was that like?
Well, my mother had come to the place before I was free. She had to wait until the army would come. As soon as the French army came, they liberated me and we came home. And we learned that father was missing. And on the Red Cross list, my father was considered as being disappeared. It was not death, but disappeared, didn't know. And we thought he was dead. And it took a long time, it took until Pentecost before he came home, that is 50 days after the liberation. And when he came home, he was deaf, he couldn't hear anything. He didn't recognize me because that has been 4 years. And he had terrible nightmares because in the last camp in Ebensee, that's Mauthausen, they had cannibalism, and since he was sick, he could not stand up anymore. He was afraid that they could try to cut something left on him to eat. So when he came home, he had terrible nightmares. We needed doctor care to get him back on his feet. Was not easy.
That must have been so difficult for you to see your dad in the condition he was in and hardly recognize you, because you've grown now since the last time he saw you. At least 4 years had lapsed. How did you finally get him? Well, let me ask a question. All three of you, your mother, you, your dad, as members of Jehovah's Witness, again, your faith had been tested. What was the lesson you learned through this terrible time period with regards to your faith?
Jehovah is a powerful God. And you could feel his approval all the time. My father once wrote in this letter, "It's a peace that we have in our mind that proves that we are on the right way." Because that peace, even if we were crying and had pains and were difficulties, but the inside peace was so strong that we knew that Jehovah was happy, content with us. So we never, never, never had the slightest idea that we should have done it differently, because it was just that standing up for the truth that gave us the strength for the next one. It was just the opposite of what the enemy thought. The enemy thought it would break us down. In reality, it lifted us up, because of our inside relationship with God.
I was reading in your wonderful book, Facing the Lion, the chapter dealing with vengeance or forgiveness. And you tell the story about the opportunity your mother had to really arrest the people who denounced her. Can you tell that story?
Yeah, she was called by the French police because they had found the list of her, of the traitors. And they told the mother, you give her, you sign the paper, and then we arrest her. And mother said, no, you do your job, but I'm not signing it. But they said, she deserves it. She said, this is your law, you apply it. I do not turn her in. And that lady was living in the same house as we did, apartment house. And she became cancer. She had no one anymore, no one to take care of her. And she was, in those days, cancer was a terrible situation because people would just rot away little by little. There was no medicine, nothing. And it's my mother that washed her every day. They brought her food, changed her bed, made her sanitary. I don't know how long she did that, but for quite a period of time. I had a hard time to understand why mother was asked, was doing this. And she said, a Christian does not retaliate. Do you know that she's really responsible, that she didn't go a wrong way because she didn't know better? It's not on us to judge people. And that became my lesson, you know, all my life. I realized that people do awful things. Doesn't mean that they're mean. They are just misled. And that had helped me a lot. Because I never suffered when somebody was hurting me. Because I always thought maybe the person doesn't know better. So this lesson has really, really shown me what it means not to retaliate. Love acts, true love, and not to retaliation.
I'm going to read the passage that's in the book for the audience because it's so powerful how you've written that. And you talk about that gentleman who had once threatened to kill your dad with an axe. And then later on brought fruits to you and fruit and vegetables from his garden on your table. Why, even your father, who had been threatened with an axe by this gentleman, agreed. And you were constantly amazed at my parents' ability to overcome resentment. They never paid back evil for evil or sought revenge. But the greatest lesson was yet to come. The wife was bedridden with terminal cancer, as you mentioned. In those days, treatment was sparse. A terrible stench came from under her apartment door. She had no help, no family, and no friends. It wasn't an easy task to wash her and change the soiled sheets, yet your mother did it twice a day for months on end. That's an amazing story. As you're here today with a special commemoration of what occurred in the judicial system here in the United States. And I wonder, is there a message that you might have, Simone, to, we have three special guests here, or even a question you might want to ask of Louise or Marie or Judith? Anything that you want to share with them at this point? Because you went through much, but yours was a flag salute case, too.
Well, I listened to the 3 days ago to some of their expressions, and we had a rehearsal with Julie. And I realized that for children, standing up day after day was a big challenge. Now, what I wonder is how they recall on it do they still think of a painful situation? Or do they see that it was a victory for the whole brotherhood? Because it took time to get that freedom back. It was not easy. It took a long time. And for children, it might be hard to grasp how important that is. But it's due to their exceptional steadfastness of them and their parents, and also the brothers who made schooling for them, that this was possible. It is Jehovah's blessing on their stand, on what they did and what they suffered, that brought the freedom for Jehovah's people. And I think they must have been feeding on them during their lives, didn't they?
Would any of you like to comment on what she just said? Her comment was essentially, you as students were tested with your steadfastness towards your belief. And I'll ask that maybe I rephrase the question by saying, you know, what was it that kind of kept that long-standing steadfastness? Do you want to start first, Louise?
I think the example that was set by the brothers and sisters in Germany during that period bolstered our integrity and our determination, and we benefited by their faith. So I think that it was Jehovah's way of giving us the courage to follow the same example.
Marie, do you have that same sense?
Yes, of course. And when I listen to Simone and all of her that she went through, it makes what I went through seem kind of unimportant or not nearly as serious as she did. It just makes me feel like she was just so much braver than I was, because she had so much more to suffer than we did here. But I appreciate what they did over there very much.
Judith, do you have a sense?
Well, I got to meet her and her husband when they were on a book tour in Atlanta, and I got to read the book, and I just thought it was so moving what she went through, and so harsh what she went through, and still persevered no matter what. So yes, she set a fabulous example for all of us.
So you are an exemplar. Your life is a message to an awful lot of people, and I have a room full of students and members of the public who are here to obtain some knowledge from you. And I know you give lots of presentations. Is there a message, Simone, that you want to make sure that everybody gets a chance to understand?
I always stress the fact that it's essential for children, because mostly the children, to get to the facts of the reality and get information. And once they have the information, then try to find out what is their own reaction and find out why we had this reaction, because our life was depending on what Jehovah is demanding on us. And usually the children do not follow, especially any religious idea. So when I talk to the children, I really stress the need of getting to know what has true values. They have to study, research, make history, and find out what is their true value. I'm not supposed to teach religion in class, so I turn around. I do not speak about the Bible says and so on and so forth. I go right down to the fact that they grow up now, the children, and they're going to have responsibility, and they need to know what the decision is going to bring out, if it is a good one or a bad one. I'm stressing a lot of the necessity of those children who are non-witnesses to find out that what has happened in Germany is not the beginning of the evil. The evil began a long time before. If they make history, they can find out that there was persecution in Europe, terrible. That's why America is made up of European people who escaped because of persecution. And they have to get to it to find out what. It's their responsibility to get this information. Because I'm not speaking to a group of brothers, I'm speaking to outsiders.
You conclude your book with the wonderful words of a Marcel Suter, who inscribed in your poetry book, "Hope is the greatest treasure. If a man has lost everything, he still possesses hope." Why did you conclude your book with that phrase?
He wrote this especially for me. He wrote this at the moment when he had to present himself to the draft. And he knew that it would mean death. He came home and said goodbye, promised that we would meet in the new world, said stay faithful, and we will come together again, we meet. So this counsel he wrote just before leaving has become my mantra. Yes, hope. If I lose everything, my parents, my health, my life, hope is not killed, because it brings the reward from Jehovah. This is why I put that in that book, because Marcel did get beheaded. And the day he was beheaded and I got the news, I was already in the penitentiary home. Even so, it hurt me to know that he had died. I was filled with a deep, 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 not happiness is not the word, a deep feeling of Marcel has become your example. He has been able to go to death without any regrets. And this is the way you want to go. This has become my direction. And at the same time, I met the burning place where they killed the Czech resistor, John Hus. And when I realized that that story came together, I said, those men have been faithful unto death. This is possible because they were only humans and they could stand faithful. There is no reason why I should not be able to stay faithful. Just follow the example.
You're amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, Simone Liebster, this is unbelievable. You provided a sense of guidance and tremendous hope for everybody, and what a guiding light. And so I on behalf of all our participants here, They're all thumbs up and thanking you for participating and drawing an appropriate closure to a wonderful event here at the Jackson Center. So again, thank you so much for taking your time.
Thank you so much, too.
Thank you. Yeah, sure. Hey, hold on to Simone, just a second. Here's the rest of the squad. Yeah, there we go. I don't know if we're still on camera or not, but this has been an amazing opportunity. And I'm frankly kind of moved by the whole show. And I've done a few of these. This is not my first rodeo. But I guess commend the Watchtower Society for putting together an incredible program. And we're just glad to have been opportunity to host it. This is history. Right here is history. We just added another element, the historical aspect of what occurred in Nazi Germany and what occurred here in the United States. These stories all interact, and when the documentarians finally get through with all of these assets that have occurred here today, it's going to be an amazing thing to share, not only among this group, but also kind of worldwide. There's a story, and there's a message, and there's a lesson. So we, on behalf of the Robert Jackson Center, are thrilled. Thank you so much to the Watchtower Society. Thank you so much for making incredible efforts. I mean, I know the incredible efforts were made to get here. I'm delighted we decided to do this in October and not December, because that would have been a greater incredible effort to get here. And so thank you, and thank you to Simone, and thanks to the technicians and all that actually make it happen. Not every Skype opportunity works. This one did, and did well, and she came across incredible well. And you need to know that she, most of you don't know, may not know that she was in the hospital. Actually got out of hospital. We assumed she was not gonna Skype in. We were into plan B, which was a taped interview. Not the same, so I'm thrilled she made an incredible effort to get on to give the message today. And that frankly touches me that she could do that, as did you folks coming in here today. So again, before I repeat myself over and over again and they give me the hook, I just wanna, we'll stand a